very much for all the nice words you found, Christoph, and I hope you believe most of them, and I'm very glad to be here with you tonight, and I think also it's a wonderful location, and maybe that's the difference between the old GDR government and a state that was not a democratic one to our democracy. We have totally different buildings. They are not so opulent like this here, and no matter. Christoph said I should talk about myself, which is kind of new experience for me, because typically we talk about topics and laws and initiatives and all this stuff, and about what entrepreneurship means, especially to me, and from a political perspective, what entrepreneurship means, and what are the challenges for us in Germany to bring more people to the idea to build their own company. And so this is the second part where I'm interested to hear from you, what you think that government should do, that politics should do, and what is the reason why you are here tonight, or why are you engaged in GTEC, and why do you plan to build your own business, and what can we do as government to help you, or what should we better not do, what could stop you. So, let me begin with myself. The wish was to present some personal things, so I do this. My name is Thomas Jarzombek. I'm now 41 years old, so I was born 1973 in Düsseldorf, a very lovely town in the west of Germany. It's the Rhineland metropole, as we call it, and so we are in between the Ruhr area and the Cologne and Bonn area, and we have a big airport and a lot of telecommunication businesses. So you can see this is the advertisement block from my hometown, and we're also strong in advertisements and different things, fashion and so on. So I was born there in 1973, and when I was a small boy, I always dreamed of building something, to be kind of an architecture or something like this. And then something happened which changed something in my life. My parents gave me a present, and that was It's the first thing I could obviously not bring in physical with me, because I still have that machine. I guess it's 30 years old and it's still standing in my flat, but in Düsseldorf, and I don't believe that once I travel with an airplane with that thing, it won't work anymore. So I left it there, but the older ones of you maybe know the Vectrex. It was kind of a game console, and so I don't know how old I've been, I guess around 10 years. And so this was the love to technology and to gadgets and all this. And so my career started. Afterwards, there came the Commodore 64. I guess there is a whole generation, the Commodore 64 generation. And what was very interesting in these years was that my parents gave me this Commodore 64. And everybody asked, are you able to program that machine? It's not the way as today, as you can say, can you Twitter or send emails or this or that? Everybody asked, are you able to program this computer? And so some kind of, I felt myself forced to program that. And I don't know if I don't believe I was very good in that, but it made a lot of fun, and I started programming this machine, and then my career got further to an Amiga 500, and in school we had Commodore PC-10, and I tried several basic and modular 2, modular 2, and Turbo Pascal, and what was quite hot these days. And in the end, my first PC, I guess I was 18, and I could program it in C. And so this was really fascinating to me. And this was the reason why I thought, okay, something with IT and with computers, this is the right thing for me. And I always had the plan in my life to build my own business. I can't tell you why, but maybe because I think I'm fascinated on creating things and to build something just from on the green field. And this is still today, I think, a very characterizing thing in my life, that I love to build up new things. And so the idea was born to do something, my own business in IT. And a second thing happened when I was, I think, 15 or 16. So this is the second thing I bring with me, and I physically bring it with me. It's my tongue. And with my tongue, you can discuss. And when I was in school, we had a class of politics, and for many, many years there were no teachers for politics. And so every year they told us, we're sorry, but you cannot have a class on politics because we don't have any teachers. And when I was 14 or 15, first time we found a teacher who could make this class of politics, and so I started discussing, and I fall in love with discussing. And you can discuss with me the whole night about everything. And my ex-wife says, I had to discuss everything with you. Yeah, and in the end, after 1 year, we didn't have any teachers left for politics, and then I asked myself, what can I do? And I thought, okay, a political party would be the right thing, the youth organization of a political party. And I realized in this year of discussing in different roles that I'm more the conservative kind of guy, and then I tried to start in the Junge Union. It's the youth organization of the Christ Democratic Union, the CDU, the party of Angela Merkel. And I realized that it's nearly the same as being an entrepreneur, because you become a job, and then nobody explains you what to do. They say, now you're the chairman of this part of Düsseldorf for our youth organization, and do something. And you don't have any clue what to do. And then I thought to myself, I make some events, and it was quite good. All people from the neighborhood were coming. I brought some politicians there, and 50 or 60 of our neighbors came to my event, and with 17 years old, I said, that's a cool thing. And it wasn't necessary to ask somebody, I just could do it. And I think this is the parallel between politics and entrepreneurship. And all the way I made in politics, you can do all the things you like to do, and it's very important to bring with you your own initiative. And afterwards, I had several functions on a municipal level, on a local level, and in 2005, I ran for the regional parliament of North Rhine-Westphalia and was elected directly there. And Germany is divided into these 16 regional states, and North Rhine-Westphalia is the biggest ones. And they all have regional parliaments where you have different issues, especially everything around education is an issue for the regional parliaments, and the different one is media affairs. And so 2 years later, I became spokesman of my parliamentary group for media affairs, and became the opportunity in 2009 to run as a candidate for the German parliament, for the Deutsche Bundestag. I was also directly elected, and from this point on, I'm making now everything around IT here. And so I come back to the first thing, to the backtracks, because after school, to go some years back, after school, I started studying economics, and in the middle, after I guess 2 years, I became the opportunity to start with a small IT business for a company that belonged to a big advertisement agency, and this was my first project. And I was recommended from one company to different companies, and even more recommended. And in the end, we were 5 people in this company, and so. This is my job. I did 10 years of IT consulting business for small and medium enterprises. And always when I was in politics, and in the beginning when I was on a municipal level, politics is just German Ehrenamt. I don't know the English word for that. Ehrenamt, that means you don't get paid for that. You do it in your spare time. And when you sit there and do the whole day IT, and in the spare time you come to the city council and you discuss about things, then it's always been the way that I was the guy for all IT and internet questions. And in 2000 and 2002 or 2003, nobody took that for serious, to be honest. When there were discussions about IT, everybody said, hey, Thomas, do that, and we don't want to spare our time, to waste our time with this stuff. And something changed in all these years, because when I was member of the German Bundestag now from 2009, we started to realize that internet and IT isn't just a business for some nerds or some freaks. We realized that internet and IT will change everything in our life. And this is what also our Chancellor Angela Merkel realized, that 10 years ago, you discussed maybe when politics looked at the internet, there were questions of intellectual property, for instance. These were all questions inside the medium internet. These were all questions about virtual things. And now it's becoming real. And if you look on an app like Airbnb, some years ago, it wasn't invented. And now, in a very short period, there are 1 million people in New York City not staying in a hotel room. They're staying in a private room. And you can see how society changes, how economics change. And I think we're just at the beginning. And it will rapidly change everything we have. Yesterday, a court had to make a decision about Uber, which changes kind of transportation services. And so Airbnb and Uber are two examples, but they're only the very, very beginning of a very, I think, very dramatic change, a very fascinating change. And I'm very glad to be in a position to work in some way on that change. And Christoph said in 2009 in the German Bundestag, it was so that before everything around internet was in a subcommittee. A parliament works in committees. We have, I think, 23 committees in the meantime. There are very established committees like Committee for External Affairs or for Interior Affairs or the Committee for Economics. And we had just a subcommittee below the Committee for Culture and Media that handled with questions about internet and IT. And in 2009, we founded a special commission, an enquete commission. There were one part were politicians and the other part were experts in that. And we discussed how will the internet change our society. And out of this, now, after the last election in the last year, we have the 23rd committee is now the Committee for Digital Agenda, for Internet Affairs, so to say. And now we are on eye level with all the old committees and all the other guys. And in 1 year now, I think we could form a lot of initiatives. Now we have an initiative to open Wi-Fi, to wireless LAN to people. Don't ask me why it took so long till today to get there, but fortunately now we're going to make it. About questions of e-government, about e-health, I think in our organization there are a lot of things we have to change. Where we are very old-fashioned, especially when you look at the government processes. There's a lot of paperwork to do. There's not so much in electronics. We're looking at Estland, which is, if you look for a country as kind of best practice, I think Estland is the right country to look at. And we have a lot of ideas in many fields. And one of our special topics is entrepreneurship. And entrepreneurship is something where we ask ourselves, Germany as a very export-oriented country, which has a lot of big companies who sell things around the world. So we can sell showers and heatings to the end of the world, to China, but in some way we have problems to bring an internet platform even to Belgium or the Netherlands. And so 2 years ago I started for myself to meet people who founded businesses around the internet, big business, venture capital, finance businesses, and who maybe have the potential to build the next Google here in Germany. And other European countries are not more successful than we are, because if you look at the whole of Europe, there are some companies like Spotify, maybe you find, which have a global position, but there are not so many. And this is the reason why we started to think, what can we do to help entrepreneurship, especially internet entrepreneurship in Germany. And the first thing we are discussing is the question about money. How can you finance a company? And in the last years, we started different initiatives. Maybe you heard about the High-Tech Gründerfonds or about Exist, which are programs on a seed stage where you can support starting companies. Right now, we are establishing a new fund on a later stage that will bring 500 million euros in the next years in the market as a co-financing with tickets up to 40 million euros. The KfW, Kreditanstalt für Wiederaufbau, it's the German subsidy bank, is starting a new program that's called 20 and 20. Means for 20 funds, they will bring 20 million euros to support them. We made something that's called investment subsidy. If you're a business angel and you want to invest in a new company on a seed level, you become a subsidy of 20%. From this year, you will become this tax-free, so this is a further incentive on that. And there are some different things we are planning to do to support on a financial level startups. But the question I'm asking myself is money everything we have to think about? And isn't it more a cultural question? And I know a guy who's a professor on the University of Duisburg-Essen, and he's doing their entrepreneurship, and in autumn he started a tour around Germany and tried to motivate people on German universities for creating an internet company. And he made a tour, he called that E-Entrepreneurship Flying Circus, Tobias Kollmann, yeah, you know him. And he started a tour, he had a cool brand for that, he promoted it on Facebook, he promoted it on the campus. And I was with him when we started at the University of Cologne. And it's a very big university, they have more than 50,000 students, and they are very strong also in economics. And I thought, okay, where will you find young e-entrepreneurs when not in Cologne? The answer would be under us, maybe in Düsseldorf, but that's a different question for the insiders. So he brought it to the Audimax, yeah, the biggest room in all this university, and there came, I don't know how many, 60 or 80 students. And so this was obvious what's our problem. From 50,000 students, there were only 60 or 80 who could motivate themselves to go to this very high-level event about how to create an internet company. And I don't know, what is the reason why people in Germany don't believe that they can build their own company? But there must be something. And maybe, and that's the third thing I could bring with me, is that somebody told me, the older you get, the less entrepreneur you are, because of our school system. Because in the beginning, when you are a child, and so this is my son, Niklas, he is now 3 months old, and Niklas, I guess it's the most important thing in my life, but you can learn from Niklas a lot of things, because he don't have any fear. Yeah, he's very experimental, he's just doing things, he's not hesitating and asks himself, is this something I can do or cannot do? He's just straightforward and he's creative. And somewhere in our school system, this creative, chaotic trial and error somehow gets lost. But I don't know the solution for this. And this is the reason why I like to discuss with you here tonight. What can we do to motivate people to build their own company? And I think one of our advantages in Germany is that we are very strong in government. We have a very strong public sector. We have very, very good people in a public sector. But if you ask the guys at the University of Cologne, what's your goal? What do you want to be when you finish your degree? Most of them will tell you, we are looking for a job in public sector. And I think that's not the right mentality. And there are several projects, even here in Berlin, I have seen, which I think are very interesting. One of these projects is to make a project week in a school. and to make a simulation of building a company. And you go in this week through all the steps. And they do it with entrepreneurs that can really tell, or they can bring over the spark that's necessary. Yeah, they don't just explain it in a technical way. They bring over the spark, why it's so fascinating to be an entrepreneur. And I asked a lot of people, why did you not build your own company? And the answer was often, I never thought about. Because maybe a lot of people cannot imagine to build a company because they think it's such a big thing and it's so complex and I don't see the beginning and I don't see the end. So maybe we need more of these projects in the schools. And a different project is that she founded a class for entrepreneurship, starting, I think, in the fifth class, so the children must be 10 or 11 years. And what's very interesting is that most of them were girls. As you see often when you're around with the startup scene here in Berlin, most of them are men, like Christoph. And like me, but I'm a politician somewhere, I could say. And there are not so many girls. And in this entrepreneurship class there in this school in Neukölln, two-thirds were girls. And so maybe this is also a way to go. But I don't think that politics can do that. Politics cannot excite people for entrepreneurship. This must come from entrepreneurs by themselves. So then you, when you start your business, you have to go to schools and to bring over this spark. No. So. Yes.
Parliament of Düsseldorf, I think there was all in it, everything. Every word was right, every sentence was right, and this must be the task for every politician in Germany to hear this and to understand this and to say, okay, this is my way to do it better.
Yeah. Well, Christian Lindner is a very good example of things going wrong, and also just in a cultural way, not in a financial way, in a cultural way, because I guess he was around 20 when he founded his business, and it was a venture capital finance business. I think they made avatars on the internet, and I spent some time in the Landtag with him, so we found some time to discuss this more in detail years ago. Yeah, and it was a company that created avatars on the internet. And I think it's a difference if you build a company in a handcraft business. Yeah, 1,000 people before built such companies, and you just can create it in the same way. And then in the end, you must be successful or not. But if you build a high tech company, there are two different things. The first thing is, can you realize the thing you try to do? Is it technically possible? It's some kind of high risk. And the second thing is, will there be a market for that? And I don't know if he brought his avatars to life, but I guess in the end, there was not a market for these avatars. And so the company ended. And for many, many years, people always pointed with their finger at him and said, you failed with your business. And so this is question culture of second chance. And in Germany, many people think it's good when everybody's equal, when they have the same clothes, the same house, the same car. Yeah? And if there's a guy with 20 years who's driving every day with a Porsche at his house, then the neighbors will say, is there everything right? That cannot be the right thing, that this 20-year-old boy has this Porsche and I'm 40 years old and I don't have one. There must be something wrong, and what he does, that cannot be legal. So this is a German thinking, yeah? German mentality, and that's a problem. Yeah? And when the company crashes then, everybody said, I knew it from the first day. Yeah? You maybe know the movie Wall Street, I like that, there's a lot of truth in it. Yeah? When Gordon, not Gordon Gekko, the other guy, but Fox, when he started, and in the end, when he's the loser, his boss said, from the first day, I knew, yeah, you're a loser. And so this is one of our problems. You can also talk about insolvency law, if there's everything right. I think we can do there some things, but most of all, this is a cultural way. And when you say every politician should hear that, yeah, it's right. I guess most of them heard it. Everybody must understand it. I'm not sure if they do. Yeah, but in the end, the decision is not if politicians believe that it's okay to have a culture of second chance. Question is of the people through Germany. Everybody understands that, and if they live a different culture. I guess we need.
It's one of the beginning points in Germany. Because Germans are looking at the parliament people and at the teachers and parliament people are the kind of teacher of German.
I'm not entirely sure. Excuse me, for questions. We have a microphone so that it's actually intelligible on the video. And when you want to put questions, please quickly introduce yourselves so that we know who we're talking to. So briefly say what you're working on and what your name is and why you're here.
Yeah, my name is Samantha. I am aspiring entrepreneur. I'm currently working in sales. I completely forgot what I was going to say. When it comes to the education and all of those things, I think that one of the major points that it's not just in Germany, but across education systems across the globe, is that everyone is focused on succeeding even then. So it's not a matter of a culture of second chance in Germany. It's a culture of you have to do it right, and you have to do it right every single time. So that at school, for example, there's nothing on monetization. There's nothing on presenting an idea, or nothing on the commercial level. So it takes until you finish school, and perhaps even finish university, and maybe you have your first year in a job, until you actually realize what you should have done and how you should have taken into consideration the second opinion. So from the political side, yeah, you could potentially change, add certain subjects and these kind of things, but it is a question of everyone teaching that it's not just success that leads you to success, but also the trial and error is a focus on the failure rather than, and what can be learned from the failure rather than like what can be learned from doing it perfectly the first time.
Yeah.
Thomas, I have a question for you. You said initially that the spark for entrepreneurship cannot come from politics, that this is something that needs to come from entrepreneurs properly, right? And I think that we agree that the least that politicians can do is not make it harder for entrepreneurs to get a company started. So at least the minimum is stay out of the way of people that want to create something. Now, some people say that the current government is doing a lot to make it harder. The legislation that was recently introduced around Mindestlohn is a big burden. It's even more bureaucracy, and in a segment that is already bureaucratized, that's one of the main points of criticism that foreign founders have when they come to Germany, that they find the German system so bureaucratic. Boom, there we have another piece of bureaucracy. There's more policies coming up in that direction. If we think about the women's quota, how is that going to be controlled? Will we have gender police policing all this? People say that 1,600 people have been employed new in order to control the minimum wage law. So there's heavy new employment in the public sector. Small wonder that people on university want to get in the public sector then, right?
I don't believe that you want to be controller of minimum wages, yeah. But nevertheless, so this is the downside of democracy, I have to say. So when we were in the campaign for the last election in autumn 2013, our coalition partner now, the Social Democrats, which run against us, yeah, the Social Democrats had some topics, and topic number one was minimum wages, to establish minimum wages in Germany. We wanted to establish minimum wages already before, but with our former coalition partner, the Liberals, it wasn't possible. our idea was that every branch could make their own minimum wages. And so not a standardized one over the whole country, over all branches. No, what we wanted to do is the social partners, the labors, the Gewerkschaften, and then Arbeitgebern. So in this system to enable every branch to make their own minimum wage. But the liberals didn't want to, and the social democrats went into this campaign and said, we want this minimum wage of 8.50 euros for everybody in Germany, and if you want that, elect us. And problem was, they weren't elected at all, so not with so many votes that they could bring the chancellor. But now they're our coalition partner. We don't have enough seats in the German Bundestag to do it for our own. We need them. And the first thing they said to us when we had this coalition treaty was they said, we want these minimum wages, and we want a quote for women, and we want to bring people with 63 years out of their jobs. And this were all program of the Social Democrats. And in the end, after the election, it was not possible to make a coalition with them without these minimum wages. And now we have very strange points in that law. We try to fix some to bring bureaucracy a little bit back. But it's not easy with the Social Democrats in the end. Yeah. Well, one thing I can say, if you look at detail, yeah, one thing is, if you're, for instance, doing transportation businesses, your employees need an income of more than 3,000 euros, because if they get less than 3,000 euros, they need a documentation every day when they started their business, the job, when they ended the job, and so, and you have to store that for years. And so all the transportation people say, that's so much bureaucracy, can't you make it easier? And I ask, why is this this threshold 3,000 euros? Because if you think somebody works 40 hours a week, this is 160 hours a month, and this to 8.50 per hour, then must be 1,400 euros or something like this. Then you can say they're becoming more than 8.50 euros an hour. No, the Social Democrats say, when somebody is working 29 days a month with 12 hours, then this will be an equal of 2,900 something euros. And I said, who in this world is working 29 days more than 12 hours? I don't know, but you. Yeah, but I guess for that you become more than 8.50 euros, I hope so.
My name is Daria. I'm an entrepreneur and I'm not the citizen of Germany. And this last year I saw a lot how people also, not only German citizens, but also people who came here to contribute to Berlin startup scene are struggling with this bureaucracy, as Christoph said. And I found your answer very, very political.
Yes.
Thank you for it. But I want to ask you pretty directly, do you think this bureaucracy can be decreased, and what do you see these ways can be? Not about what political parties for which direction, but what can be really done,
yeah,
and whether it can be done at all. Thank you.
Sorry, I don't understand what kind of bureaucracy you mean by that. What exactly do you mean?
Yeah.
What do you mean? What's the problem?
Of course. For example, the majority of startups, they actually start as freelancers. So the one personality has an idea and starts to work on it on his own. So now to start being a freelancer, in Germany you need to fill so many documents, and really to understand them, it takes lots of time, and lots of people are just also afraid of doing a mistake, because then they can face fines or other legal issues. Nobody wants to have. And especially, I see it, of course, among international crowd.
Yeah. So maybe these public forms are an example why we are a trial and error state, because for German people also it's nearly not possible to fill out correctly a lot of these forms. So it's kind of trial and error. You start with something and you become it back from the government, and then you have a second chance often. But they're very complex. So I know that from people who are lawyers, and I think always lawyers are the ones who must understand that. Yeah. To be honest and to give a honest answer, I don't believe in the end that we can reduce bureaucracy in a way that it's significant. We tried a lot of initiatives. We have a Norman Kontrollrat. It's kind of the strategy is to make a report how big are the costs of bureaucracy, and from that on say we have some goals to reduce these costs of bureaucracy. It's a model established in the Netherlands. We adopted that. We did it, and we achieved some goals, but I don't think that anybody in this country would say in the end we, for ourselves, realized that bureaucracy was significantly reduced. That's one of the problems. And now with every new initiative like the minimum wages, there are coming bureaucracy costs to it. And then we made a policy that says one in, one out, that is only allowed to make new bureaucracy if you reduce some other bureaucracy. And now we will see what's going to happen, but I believe that with the next election you will also gain bureaucracy. And this is maybe a problem of a democracy, that systems are very complex, and there is for every decision you have hundreds of people which are working on that decision. And in the end of the room somebody's asking, and what is when this and that? And then so the rule is getting longer and longer and longer. And something we should do, and where I am working for, is to make more e-government. Because I believe that things will get easier if you don't have to go to the office, if you have files online. And for this, we are trying one project right now. This is on e-health. If you're going to a doctor in Germany, everything is paperwork. When you check in at the doctor, you have to fill out paperwork. Everything he's getting to know from you, he is writing down, and he will keep that in his office. And if you go to the next doctor, he cannot access the files of the last doctor. And if you become medicine, there's no system that checks if it's a good idea to combine all this medicine you have. There is an online dealer, Doc Morris, maybe some of you know them. In all the years they are operating right now, they had 60,000 patients which ordered medicine that was incompatible. And they wrote a letter to them and said, okay, you ordered this medicine from us, but if you take this to yourself together with the other medicine you already ordered, this won't be a good idea. And so the idea we have now is to establish something that's called in German ein Rechtsanspruch. You have the right to apply, that everybody in this health system, which you come together with, must upload all the files belonging to you to a cloud provider of your choice. And this should be accessed with your new, we're also working on that, our personal ID, to make this new personal ID even newer, to have it as a kind of universal authentication tool. Yeah? And so that no matter to which doctor you go, you have the right to say, please load all the files up to my cloud provider. And if you go to the next doctor, you have the right to say to them, you have to look at all the files in the cloud. And so this is one of a lot of initiatives around e-government I'm working on. I cannot tell you if this will become true, if we become a majority for this, but this is, politics is often also kind of trial and error. I'm one of 620 members of parliament here, and I need a lot of different colleagues to become a majority for such an initiative. And sometimes we become a majority, sometimes not.
Yeah, hello, I'm Lucas, entrepreneur here in Berlin. And one question that is particularly puzzling me since I arrived here in Berlin was why there's, because there's a, let's say, we were talking about bureaucracy before, and there's quite of a fear culture, let's say, about different things that you have to do when you arrive here in Germany. I think that was made really clear by so many people. And I was always wondering why you would apply so many of the rules which are, let's say, needed for like having a basis of economic exchange. Why are they needed for early stage startups? I'll come to a list of things in a moment. So most early stage startups are more concerned about getting their product to function, like you said in the beginning, with technological risk, and finding a market before selling it. And then you have to concern yourself with things like, this starts very easy, like there's fear culture around Impressumspflicht, a very aggressive execution of it. Insolvenzverschiebung, also right from the start, oh, you can found your company for €1, but if you do that, then it's Insolvenzverschiebung. There is, just those things come up all the time. And my question is really, why does it have to concern entities which are not making profit whatsoever? So in comparison to Ireland, there's no notary requirements in Ireland. There is no need to do annual returns for the first 2 years of trade unless your annual revenue exceeds €300,000. Why do such initiatives or exceptions don't exist for startups in Germany?
So these are different topics. I don't think that we need a kind of subsidy race between European countries. And I know there are some countries who are doing a lot of subsidies on a tax level and on different levels. So if you take Ireland and say for the first 2 years they don't have to pay any taxes.
But it's not about the taxes, it's about the bureaucracy that comes with it, because you're not going to come to Germany and first thing look for a Steuerberater. That's just, for me, that doesn't make sense. First, I want to build the product, I want to verify that there's a market, and I want to actually sell the product. Then I will think about Steuerberater and notaries and all those things.
But in some way, it's also German tradition, and you can say, is tradition good or is it bad, or why don't we cut it all off? But I guess there are a lot of reasons why we have this notary system. To go to the next point, this notary system, and we discussed that in the last 2 years often. If there would be more business in Germany, if it would be able possible to make the contracts in English language, or if to be freed of these notaries, but I don't believe that these are the mission critical points in the end. Maybe yes, maybe not. I cannot tell you. Yeah, but it's. It would be a very, very large complex to get rid of these. And I think these are other points which are deciding for the question, are we an entrepreneur country or are we not?
But you're applying rules of economic exchange on entities which do not, at the moment, undertake any economic exchange. And this is very disturbing.
Yeah, you're right. And I could tell the same. I do it often. But I have a lot of colleagues who have a different perspective on that. And they say, so intellectual property is a very important thing. And it's very important that the authorities get to know who's the guy behind this internet number and this and that. And I don't know. Look at this discussion about this Wi-Fi law we are doing right now. Yeah. That's not my... I share your perspective on that.
You're very brave, Thomas, to come. Hi, I'm Luisa. I'm director of the GTEC Lab, so the entrepreneurship center that we're building here. And yeah, thanks so much for joining us here. You're very, very brave to step into a room of entrepreneurs as a member of parliament and then obviously get the brunt of our frustrations. But actually, more on a personal level, what got you to step out of I suppose you still have entrepreneurial things that you do, but to actually stop working at driving a company and that part of entrepreneurship and actually be like one of those students that wants to step into politics?
Yeah. So I think my entrepreneur experience is driving a lot of my political views, and everything you told about bureaucracy I learned from my own in a very practical way. There are much worse things than the ones you described. Once it comes to statistics, as an entrepreneur you have to fill out a lot of very complex forms and different things. But in the end, I think it's an advantage to understand both sides. And also politicians are not entrepreneurs when it comes to decisions, because it's not the way that you can say, so I take it on my own and we do this just and we try it out, and if it doesn't work, we try it in a different way. It's democracy in Germany is very complex because after World War II, we had very bad experiences with efficient systems, yeah, so to say. And so the fathers of our constitution had the goal to build a very complex system where decisions take a very long time and where a lot of people are engaged and have to discuss Bundestag with Bundesrat and Bundesregierung and all the judges around. And so it's very, very complex, and at some points also very frustrating. This is very different to entrepreneurship, because you cannot say, this is my idea, I just do it, I have a budget, we try it out, and if it's not working, we stop it. So democracy is working different. And so this is the way, in all the time I was active in my company, it was a very big advantage on some days where I couldn't stand it anymore, all these discussions and compromises and not going forward, to come to my company and to say, okay, three things we just do right now, and it's decision and we do it. Yeah. And I miss it in some way, because the last 5 years now I'm here in Berlin, in German Bundestag, I'm not active employee in my company anymore, but I'm still owning a part of it. And once I will not be a member of the parliament, maybe I come back to this company, or maybe I build a new company. And I think this will be a great experience to create and to start something new, and maybe experience to be free again out of all these complexity we have here in finding decisions. And I'm looking forward to that day. And sometimes when I'm in the morning under the shower, I think about ideas I could realize. But you better know than I do that idea is not the main thing. The main thing is to have a team that does it and that has the ability to bring an idea to life. Yeah.
Okay, then I introduce myself at first. My name is Stefan. I was a banker for 27 years until 2013, and quit it because it was boring. And so I decided to be a business angel and entrepreneur. I founded my company just 2 hours ago, and yeah, just as I was at the notary today, and I visited my Steuerberater, yes, of course, and my lawyer and everything. And so I think it would be a great chance to have an open office, online and offline, in every parliament in Germany, Bundestag, and maybe also in every big city, just to speak with people like you, to know you. Nobody knows you really from the entrepreneurs. I was at the Startup Camp Berlin at the Humboldt Universität last weekend. It was great. We were 180 people, young people mostly, so I'm a little bit older. And so it was, I think we are on the right way, especially in Berlin. I don't know how it is in Düsseldorf, but I will found a company together with somebody from Düsseldorf. Mm-hmm. And we hopefully build the new Google and Facebook and Amazon together. Yes.
It'll be great.
But maybe you can help.
Yes, I would like to help if there's a possibility. And I think also we are on a good way. There are a lot of challenges, or you could say we have a lot of problems. Yeah, but it's some kinds are not only weaknesses. In some ways, they're also strengths, that Germany is very exact and our law system is really very exact. And that we, but on the other side, when you look back 5 or 6 or 7 years, I don't think that there you couldn't find a lot of people who founded an internet business or internet business that was successful or going abroad. And so in the last years, I've met a lot of entrepreneurs which founded very creative businesses, which successful businesses, always stronger businesses. One is in my home city in Düsseldorf is Trivago. Three guys that started in, we had, when I was at school, we had parties in that location. It was called Consum, and they started there, these three guys, and now this company is worth 5 billion euros. It's a great story, and now they are heading to 2,000 employees in Düsseldorf. It's really great. And so I try to bring these people to my colleagues, so that they can smell what it means to be an entrepreneur, so that they can see what's necessary. And especially now with Trivago, we have all these issues. I'm glad that nobody of you asked how to bring people from other countries here and to become a license for them that they are allowed to work here. And we have so terrific stories, I cannot tell you, from Trivago, from Rocket, from however, whom you're talking to. And I think there's something Peter Tauber, who is now General Secretary of the CDU, is a colleague of me, and in the last years we did all this internet politics together. And so his major point is we need a new law for migration to make it easier for people to come into Germany and to work here. If they are, like in a way Canada does or United States does, if they are motivated, if they have the right skills, and if they get a job here. And I think for the last 20 or 30 years, we are not making good politics in this field, because we only, if you're coming from a different European country, it's something else, because all over Europe, you have freedom to live wherever you like to and to work wherever you like to. But for people coming outside of the European Union, it's nearly impossible. You can only come if you say there is a war in my home country, or they forced me because of my political opinions.
Is there a quick question on that? How does the blue card system work?
Bad, very bad. Yeah, officially, the government would say it's great success, but in the end, I know so many cases where it doesn't work, where it's complex, and where companies are negotiating for months and months with the authorities to get people into Germany, and it's extremely complex. And I think we need a radical change in that field.
You mentioned that too many people want to become public servants, right?
Yeah.
Now, in parliament, most of, or like the largest group of parliamentarians have a background in public services. I don't know how many or how very few parliamentarians and politicians in Germany have an entrepreneurial background, but what I do know is that Ms. Nahles, who introduced the Mindestlohn, has never worked a single day in a real job. And recently there was a comment of the General Secretary, Ms. Fahimi, I think, calling entrepreneurs stupid who didn't know how to manage the bureaucracy around Mindestlohn. And she either has not worked a single day in her life in a regular job, let alone that she's been an entrepreneur. And these two examples, they happen to be both on the Social Democrat side. But my feeling is that you have a lot of people in the Christian Democrat throughout the government that have absolutely no relation with starting a business or suffering through a career and really building something. How is that affecting government policy? And isn't that also one of the reasons why so many people want to rather have a public services job than starting something?
No, these are only people at the Social Democrats.
Happen to be.
No, actually, it's not this way. I don't know. You have a lot of entrepreneurs in German Bundestag, but a lot of them are freelancers, lawyers, for instance. I think the biggest group are lawyers. We have more than 100 lawyers in the German Bundestag, and I think lawyers are not the people who reduce complexity or make processes even faster. Yeah. I don't say anything against lawyers. My wife is a lawyer, but it's a very different approach doing things if you're a lawyer. And we have a lot of public servants also. And maybe it's a question about risk or not being being risk averse. And if you're running for parliament, you're elected for 4 years, and there's no guarantee that you will be re-elected 4 years later. And your own performance is nearly irrelevant on the question if you get re-elected. Look at all these guys at the Liberal Democrats. They've got out of the parliament and they had really, really very good parliamentarians. But the top management made some mistakes and all the rest from the MPs flew out of the parliament. And we have that experience also. If you have the wrong candidate or if Angela Merkel would make a very big mistake, then in the end we would lose so many votes that a lot of colleagues would leave the parliament. And so it's kind of unfair, or maybe it's high risk in some way. And if you're an entrepreneur and you run for such a job, you have to leave your company in some way, because being an MP is a really hard job. You never get at home before 10 or 11 p.m. You're the whole weekend on the way to events. So I cannot see, if you really work on your job as MP, it's not possible to be to have an entrepreneur job beside that. And so you have to leave your old job. You get this one for 4 years, you don't know what's coming behind, and that's the reason. And you don't get, from a perspective of an entrepreneur, you're not going paid so enormously. And in the end, this is the reason why a lot of entrepreneurs don't look for running as a candidate. I think doors would be open for, but the German system is also not in that way that you can say, so I'm a successful entrepreneur, and now today I have the idea to run as a candidate tomorrow, because it's also a question of trust, and I guess parties like people, like to get people to know some years, and this is the second part of this story.
So what you're saying is, like with bureaucracy, it's probably not going to change, that politics in Germany that are related to fostering entrepreneurship are made by people who have no clue of entrepreneurship and have never worked in a entrepreneurial job.
Yeah, the ones
and that's
that
the way how it's going to be.
The ones that fostering entrepreneurship, I guess, have an entrepreneur background. Yeah, I don't think that Andrea Nahles and Frau Fahimi see their main mission in fostering entrepreneurship. I don't
they see it in blocking it.
Yeah.
Which is your government?
Hi, my name is Mihai Streza. I work for a family office called Equal Capital, so we invest in early stage. You mentioned key points, and you mentioned at one point in your speech that these are not actually the key points, and I agree with that, because I think everything we've been discussing until now are not the key points about entrepreneurship. I mean, I have total understanding for everybody who's annoyed by the so-called bureaucracy. I have dual citizenship. I'm a German citizen as well, but not primarily citizen of Germany. I went through all these things. I founded 3 companies in Germany. I never found it to be particularly difficult.
Yeah.
For being a freelancer, you need to fill out one form. Maybe you need to go to this office one time. The Mindestlohn, I don't think it's a problem, and I'm speaking as an entrepreneur and as a venture capitalist. I don't think that the Mindestlohn is a problem, that the minimum wage is a problem. A lot of these things are annoying, or they're not great, but they're like small nuisances, right, in my humble opinion. And that's why I don't think they are key points. And if somebody thinks that Ireland is better because it's easier there, then I think you should go to Ireland and find a company there. It's internet companies anyway, most of them, so you don't have to be in Germany. But I'd like to hear from you what you think are the key points, because one of them, I'll tell one of them in our opinion, as a family office who's investing own family money. One of them is the 3.7% of GDP that's not being invested, that has been made public by Herrn Fratscher from Deutschen Institut für Wirtschaftsforschung. Also in Germany, deriving it from the macroeconomic condition, you would need to invest 3.7% of Germany's GDP in surplus what's being invested now, and that's not being invested. And we actually have an open petition to Frau Merkel on this and on how this could be fixed. But I think that's a major point. There's a huge lack of money to be invested. And if you go to a bank, you will hit a wall because they will ask you how much revenue do you make, you know, what's your history of 3 years. You don't have access to capital. You have a couple of VCs, you have some family offices, but you don't have access to capital. And I think so we argue that that's a major problem, but I would be curious if you agree with that, and what other key points do you see?
Yeah, in the end, I have to say, as an economy, in some way, but if you look at the last 5 or 10 years, we're quite successful. And if you look today, how the change of the GDP is going, now it should be 2.2%, I read in a newspaper this morning. So it's straight going forward. Nevertheless, we have all this bureaucracy and all these problems, and I agree to you that it's annoying to have this bureaucracy, but in the end, I guess if you have the idea to build a company, if you have the right product, and if you have the right team, then you will do it. And no matter if you have to have this notarial stuff or not or whatever, it blocks you, no question, but you will do it. And so next question is, are we investing enough? No, I don't think that we are investing enough. I believe that's a problem you have in all established democracies, because with every election you have no new projects, and these new projects are normally not to create more roads out there or to create better railways or something like this. For example, you have the question, what to do with small children, and where is the compatibility between family and job? And now in the last years, we built in Germany a lot of institutions where you can bring your small children under 3 years. And so we spend a lot of money, but investment, you would say invested money is only in these buildings, but the major part of the money went to the people which work in these facilities. And so from every election, you have projects more and more which are not investment or investing projects. And I don't think that's only in Germany. You can look all over the world, look at the roads in the United States. So once a year I'm in Silicon Valley, and if you go there from San Francisco to Palo Alto, you see roads, they're much worse than the ones we have here. It's a real problem, but it seems to be kind of imminent to the system. And now you read in the papers we have a new program from Wolfgang Schäuble of 10 billion euros just for investments. With the coalition treaty, beside all these minimum wages things, we have a 5 billion investment in our infrastructure. So we created new programs with more investment volume. And last point you asked is what about financing companies and founders, especially from the banks. And so there I believe we will not create companies with banks, because banks don't understand these business models. Banks cannot help the entrepreneurs. They don't have a network for them. They don't have technology for them. They don't have experience in a special field which they can present to them. And what we learn from Silicon Valley is that there are ecosystems in a way that people who were successful with building a company invested the money they earned in new companies, and with a feeling for the market, with a feeling for the products. And therefore it's very important, and that's one of my key points, it is very important that the ones which are successful stay here in Germany and invest in Germany. And for instance, these guys from Trivago, I brought them to an event with Chancellor Merkel, and they could talk to her, and she said, I think it's great what you're doing. This is also something, it's not only a law or a financial program. Sometimes it's that the chancellor comes to an entrepreneur and says, that's a great job you're doing, and we are proud to have you here in Germany. It's really important. And if you look at the Oliver Samba and Rocket, I think he don't need that, but in the end, I'm sure also Oliver Samba don't want to hear the whole day that he is a shark. Some way he wants to hear, we are proud of you as Germany, that you created all these companies here and so many jobs. And I think that's necessary. And in the end, I think on this way we are not so unsuccessful. And I found some of real successful entrepreneurs who posted pictures of themselves with Angela Merkel, and so it seems to work. And all the rest, what are the key facts? I don't know. I think we are a very stable system. We have a very big market. We have a lot of talented people here in Germany. With all the problems we see, but we have a good education system. I think these are advantages. You have in Berlin a city which is very international, a city which is quite disruptive, where people from all over the world come to Berlin because the city fascinates them with the history of this divided city and everything creative, chaotic happening here. So maybe we have some key advantages. So this is also typical German perspective, only to look at the problems. Yeah? So it's the difference between, I don't hope you have people, too many people from Italy. I have an Italian car, so I can tell you from my personal experience. Yeah, if an Italian car is created, then the engineer standing there just saw a shot on TV. Some forgotten the word. I saw on TV about forgotten the brand. It was Lamborghini, where the people who built the Lamborghini said. So, and we always heard when somebody left our property, if he shifted to the fifth gear, and then we said the car must work. Yeah. So, and but Italian guys maybe are fascinated about and say what kind of gorgeous car we created. And the German perspective, when the Mercedes comes out of the factory, the Germans then say, but this side is 1 millimeter too thick than the other side. Yeah. So this is in some way a problem because we never say, "Oh, it's so gorgeous and so big what we are creating." And we're always looking at the problems. And say, oh, everything's worse. Problems. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Monica, and I'm a Bundeskanzler stipendiatin from India, and I am working on a research project which tries to explore the synergy between the actions, the socially responsible actions of corporations as well as citizens, and tries to map it to the upcoming sustainable development goals. So my question sort of revolves around the same. What is the perception and the measures that the German government is taking towards creating an open dialogue-oriented participatory platform where citizens can directly interact with the members of parliament and they can, you know, get to know about the status of the projects that they want on priority to be done, and you know, a sort of a very suggestive platform which is existing in Greece, which is existing in other Ireland, I believe. So what is the status or the perception in Germany regarding one such platform?
Yeah, we've experimented with that in this enquete commission I told you in the last years. And we made an open platform where you could present ideas, you could discuss ideas, you could vote ideas from others. But it was quite frustrating to see that working because there were only a few people who came with their ideas to that platform. For my topics, there have been 20 or 30 people who engaged themselves on this platform from 80 million inhabitants here. And so in the end, we couldn't tell our colleagues this is such a great thing, we have to roll it out in a bigger amount, because in the end you need a budget for that, and it's quite a big budget to have such a solution really professional. And so now we have kind of light versions of that. Yeah. But on the other side, you find people like me walking around, also my constituency, all the time, and we have open doors in our offices, and you can come with all your problems, no matter what it is, and we get a lot of letters and emails, and we're discussing with people on conferences, on video calls, and whatever you like to. So maybe it's a different thing than to create an internet platform for that, but what we tried with internet platforms wasn't successful at all, because there were not enough users on that.
Given the fact that the internet penetration rate in Germany is one of the highest in the world, there are not many people who are engaging with the platform. Is what the problem is. Okay.
Let's hear one more question.
What I would be interested in is actually what is the, let's say, the agenda in the committee for internet at the moment, so in the present session, and what would be your personal goals in this sector?
At first, my personal goal is to establish that committee, to become respect from our colleagues, and to be kind of consultant to our colleagues in the other committees. Because we have a lot of topics which belong to more than one ministry or to more than one other committee. And so the best thing we have is a good argument. And what we see now as a role is that now we are established for 1 year, that colleagues from the other committees come to ask and ask us, what do you think about our projects? What is your expertise on that? What should we do different? And so this is maybe my structural goal, so to say. From the content side, we are working on a lot of topics. I'm also my personal interest very much in transportation politics. And so I'm working on everything around data and transportation. I want to establish a connection between all the traffic lights and the cars so that you have a city where no car has to brake anymore. Where you become an information, your car becomes the information, when will the traffic light be green, and so it can drive with exactly the speed that's necessary to arrive at this traffic sign when it's green, so that you reduce pollution and you reduce noise and everything. I want to establish more open data, not only for transportation, but for a lot of fields. I want to get a new philosophy or a new perception of the opportunities of data. Because Germany, this time, data processing is always seen as a problem. We have this paradigm of Datensparsamkeit, to store as few data as possible. And we see, especially from the United States, that data is the main driver of innovation, and the more data you collect, the more innovation you can get. But Germans are very focused on privacy, and today we had a meeting for 1.5 hours, and we fought it against the government, who didn't want to open up all the data on this lorry toll. You know, in Germany for 10 years, lorries have to pay a toll, and they have some kind of onboard unit. And if you could use that data from this onboard unit, you could have a perfect traffic prediction, because you know everywhere around all the streets where is a traffic jam and where is it not, and how many cars are on which streets. And for years and years and years, nobody tried to open up this data because they all feared that the public would not accept that we can open this data. And so this is more a philosophy question than a practical question. And today we became a majority. I hope this will also become a law. That's quite a long way to go, but on a very mission critical point, we became a majority for opening up this data in a for whatever reasons. And so these are just a few examples, and our strategy is not that we say, okay, we need 1, 2, 3. Our strategy is more that we say on every political aspect, on every ministry or other committee, we want to apply some projects, and we want to bring their more IT expertise in that. And I gave you some more examples, questions of how to foster founders is one, how to get them more financial support for them. Is for instance one, and this e-health thing I told you about is one on my personal priority very high, and I'm looking for some disruptive opportunities, so to say, where we can, with a right for people to something or to opening some data, to enable innovation where founders could use that to create businesses, and maybe businesses before such kind of opportunities come in other countries, and you have an advantage, and you can build up a company here, which maybe can be successful in other countries too.
Thank you so much, Thomas. That was a very interesting evening, and you have told us many interesting things about yourself and what you're working on and what the limitations are on what you're working on. I hope you will stay with us for another 10, 15 minutes so that we can have a drink and a donut back there at the bar. And anyone who's interested can try to grab Thomas and ask him some questions off the record. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much for the invitation and spending your time with me. Thank you.
Thomas Jarzombek.